Greetings, friends and family of the Now Church channel. This is Ras Ber I. I want to welcome you in the name of the Almighty, Haile Selassie I Jah Rastafari, Jesus Christus, King Alpha and Queen Omega, and let's get right into it. How could Lee Scratch Perry be left out of the Bob Marley movie? The Bob Marley One Love movie is doing very well at the box office, but it does have some flaws and omissions. For example, though Cox and Dodd, the producer music mogul who first contracted the Wailers, was featured, they put the time period in the mid to late 60s when the band was in their late teens or early 20s. In reality, it was the early 60s, and the band were kids in their early teens. The movie portrayed Coxon as a gun-toting bully, perhaps combining the real Coxon with Duke Reed of Treasure Isle Records, who was a gun-toting bully. Far from a bully, Coxon allowed a young Bob Marley to live in the Brentford Road Studio One compound and paid for his wedding to Rita. I viewed the movie, and I did not see or hear a Lee Scratch Perry character. I've been told that there is a short flash of a Lee character supposedly skanking at the Wailers' audition for Mr. Dodd. That flash can never do justice to the crucial role Lee Perry played in Bob's development. Lee Scratch Perry, the mighty upsetter, was a super innovative producer and artist, closely associated with the invention of reggae, dub, raga, drum and bass, and dubstep. He was a recognized producer and label head when Bob approached him for help in the late 60s. Scratch gave Bob a room in his home, instruction and confidence in his singing, and help with his writing. He also produced tracks for Bob, Peter, and Bunny, classic tracks like Soul Rebel, Small Axe, and Duppy Conqueror, that heralded Bob's new persona as the Rasta Rebel chanting down the Babylon system. The Bob Marley that the world would come to know as the reggae star was formed under the tutelage of Lee Perry. They did have a falling out when Scratch licensed Wailers' music to Trojan Records in England, but they got over it, and it popularized the Wailers' music in England and Europe. Scratch was a prolific maverick in his own right, a righteous obium science man, griot, kabbalist, musical healer, shaman, and rastaman. He was so far outside the box that many called him mad, but he was just the kind of free spirit Bob needed to influence him. He even had a major hand in co-writing Bob's songs at the time. Even after Bob signed with Chris Blackwell's Island Records, he continued recording at Black Ark Studios, which was started in 1973, with Scratch, and co-writing songs with The Upsetter. Bob's rhythm section, the Barrett Brothers, Family Man and Carlton, were originally Lee's rhythm section. Let's look at some of the tracks that they did together at that point in time. Tracks like Jah Live, the music media and international media had announced that Emperor Haile Selassie I of Ethiopia had died. But Scratch and Bob made their response, saying that no, the emperor was still living. Jah cannot die. The first recording of Natural Mystic was done with Scratch, as well as Rainbow Country, which celebrates Bob's love of nature, driving through Jamaica, and the unity of all peoples. Smile Jamaica, which was a celebration of the people of Jamaica and was written to cool down the deadly political violence and warfare, especially in Kingston. Black Man Redemption, in which he emphasizes the black liberation roots of Rastafari and again tells the youth to cool down and have cool runnings. Punky Reggae Party, a track recorded in London and produced by Scratch and co-written by him, featuring a large assortment of the top reggae musicians at the time. In the Wailers Band, members of Aswad, members of the Now Generation. It was a tribute to the English punk movement and its rebellion against the establishment. The idea originated with Scratch, who was in London doing production work for the punk group The Clash. There are quite a few more tracks that were done between Bob and Scratch, but that would take a long time to go through, so I will just cite one more. Rastaman Live Up, which was recorded when Bob knew he was passing, telling the Rasta community to keep on trotting strong, though it was released posthumously. I rest my case. Lee Perry was the greatest influence on Bob. He was the most significant producer Bob ever worked with. Apart from Joe Higgs, he was the greatest influence musically on Bob, yet he is not featured prominently in the Bob Marley movie Hollywood production. The Upsetters' work with Bob is just the tip of the iceberg of his classic productions. It would take several more episodes to cover those. The Great Scratch passed on August 29th, 2021. Long live the mighty Upsetter, Lee Scratch Perry. If you enjoy these programs and you're interested in personal spiritual guidance, meditation instruction, spiritual readings, financial tips, and natural health information and products, please contact I, Ras Ber I, at the email which will be in the notes below. Jah bless each and every one. Rastafari. Blessings itinerary.